Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, welcome my dear respected brothers and sisters to this episode tonight where we are speaking about a very great tabi'i indeed. He is known as Uwais al-Qarni. Subhanallah, Uwais al-Qarni comes from Yemen. And subhanallah, we find that when Uwais al-Qarni, rahmatullah alayhi, he's a tabi'i. Screen, let's put the screen up. So Uwais al-Qarni, rahmatullah alayhi, subhanallah, he comes from a place called Yemen. And Allahu Akbar, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks very highly about him in the ahadith, and there's ahadith in Sahih Muslim as well. Why today we chose about speaking regarding this great personality called Uwais al-Qarni? Because my beloveds, unfortunately today, our parents, after we pass the phase of them taking care of us, and we graduate, and we become independent in our own lives, we have our own wife, our own husband, and own children, and own jobs, and we become very independent. Slowly, slowly, we drift away from our parents. And what happens is, especially our mothers, subhanallah, they might be daily thinking about us and daily making dua for us. But subhanallah, because we are so busy in what we are doing, we tend to forget them. Or they are on our minds, but they are always secondary. If an important call comes from, subhanallah, some business dealer, or it's coming to buy some of our products, we will immediately take that call. And we will ensure that, subhanallah, we will speak and we will sometimes be half an hour on that call. But whilst we are in our race of life, whilst we are doing what we are doing, our mother calls us. Immediately we say to ourselves, oh, okay, it's the old lady. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll speak to her later. I'll speak to her on the weekend. And my beloved, subhanallah, we don't realize the value of a mother until and unless we lose them. Ask those who misses their mother, and all they can do is go to the graveyard and go besides the qabr and read for her. Allahu Akbar. Come with me to Yemen. Now Yemen is definitely a place that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved. Yemen was a place that Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, al-hikmatu yamaniyya. Hikmah and wisdom and iman belongs to the people of Yemen. Many sahaba came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam from Yemen. Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu was from Yemen, the sahabi that would recite very beautiful. Sayyidina Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu was from Medina. But Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam sent him as a mufti to serve the people of Yemen. And until today, there are places in Yemen when you go, it takes you back to the memories of sahaba. They live so simple and they are so humble people. My beloved, subhanallah, Uwais al-Qarni, the person and the champion of today's story, is from Yemen. He heard about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he was still young. His father was a very, very dutiful Muslim. But his father passed away whilst Uwais was still very young. So his mother began taking care of Uwais. And he grew up in his mother's lap. His mother, subhanallah, worried about him, took care of him, tended to him. And today when we have our own children, and at nights we have restless sleeps because this child's tooth is paining, the other child, subhanallah, can't sleep, she's scared because there's something in the room, so you have to sleep with her. Then the other one, subhanallah, he is, Allahu Akbar, up at night on his phone, you have to quickly go and watch and see that he is sleeping. And then you got the baby, subhanallah, and the baby is, Allahu Akbar, crying in the middle of the night. And sometimes you have to just rock and rock and rock till the baby sleeps. These all refreshing memories. That one day we all were small. We all were young. And it took my mother and your mother to rock us to sleep. It took my mother and your mother to say lullabies, subhanallah, to put us and cuddle us to sleep. It's sometimes our mothers and our fathers, subhanAllah, were separated. They wanted to spend quality time together, but they could not because we as children were in the way. As our children, we took quality time from our mothers and our fathers, subhanAllah, had to be alone. And sometimes we took quality time from our fathers, where they had to drop us at school, and they had to take us to university, and they had to work hard hours to pay our fees. And that time could have been spent with our mothers. So subhanAllah, Uwais al-Qarni grew up under the shade of his mother. And Allahu Akbar, when he was of age now, and he was a young man, Nabiyyu Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in Medina now. And the stories of Medina is flooding into Yemen. Sahaba are going. In the morning this caravan is going. In the evening that caravan is coming. And everyone is speaking of how they met this great prophet, Nabiullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they're speaking about his exemplary character. And they're speaking about when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiles, the nur that emits. And they're speaking about the barakat and the darajat of the Sahaba. And Sayyidina Uwais al-Qarni's heart is yearning to go to Medina and be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he approaches his mother and he says, "Mom, look, I really want to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I really want to be counted amongst the galaxy of Sahaba, and I want the suhbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if it be a minute or two." And subhanAllah, his mother said that, "Oh Uwais, I am blind. I cannot see. So if you are not around, who will take care of me? But if you insist, I will be more than happy that you go to Medina. But you spend a very short while in Medina, not more than 3 days. And in some narrations, just one night, one day. Meet the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fulfill your desire. Become a sahabi. Get his du'as. And then immediately turn back and come back to me. For a month or two, I can make sabr and have patience. But not longer." So Uwais al-Qarni is very glad. On the one side, he's dutiful to his mother. He loves his mother. He cares for his mother. But what greater than becoming the sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What a greater virtue. And Allahu Akbar, my beloved brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. Wouldn't we want to give everything we have in life to meet the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith that subhanAllah, Allahu Akbar, a time will come before Qiyamah, people will be so, subhanAllah, heart aching to meet me, craving to meet me, enthusiastic to meet me, that a person will be willing to give whatever he owns, to spend just a moment in my company. People will really, there will be some people in my ummah that will cry that I want to meet and be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we go to Madinatul Munawwara and may Allah ta'ala open the doors and take us all there again, we go to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And wallahi, you come to the old part where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would sit with his sahaba. And you just tear up and you look at those stuffs and you think, one day Abu Bakr and Umar would perform salah here. In the past, Sa'id bin Zayd would stand here. This was the pillar where Allahu Akbar Abu Lubaba was tied. This was the pillar where Rasulullah would perform his tahajjud. And those old memories of 1400 years comes back as if it is still happening before you. And then you say, "I wish I just had one day in my life or one moment in my life that I could enter Medina whilst the Prophet sallallahu alaihi was still alive. And I could humble myself and I could kiss his hands." And subhanAllah, we cannot do that. But Rasulullah SAW said that a time will come, subhanAllah, that the ummah will really, really crave for that. But subhanAllah, inshaAllah, we have Jannah. And that's why someone said, "Shawwiqna ila al-Jannah." Oh Shaykh, give us the motivation of going to Jannah. And the Shaykh answered, "Fiha Rasulullah." In there, we will be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So my beloved, subhanAllah, Uwais al-Qarni also has this enthusiasm to, subhanAllah, be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Uwais al-Qarni then comes to Madinatul Munawwara, picks him up the valleys, picks him up the mountains, drops him the valleys, meaning he traverses a hard terrain. Yemen is covered with a lot of mountains. And Allahu Akbar, he comes finally, after several weeks, to Madinatul Munawwara. When you come to Madinatul Munawwara, normally if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there, automatically the beautiful scent and fragrance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, إِذَا أَفْقَدُوكَ يَمَّمُوهُمْ رَائِحَتُكَ, that your smell or fragrance of Rasulullah is like a navigation. That if someone comes to Medina, they just get this breeze and this beautiful scent, follow it and it will lead you right to the lap of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Uwais comes and he's looking for the Prophet of Allah, but neither does he get that scent, nor fragrance, nor nur. And he comes and he finds the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quite empty. Few sahaba are there. And he asked them, where is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This journey has taken me. I am all excited. I want to meet the Prophet of Allah. My time has come to become a sahabi. And the sahaba said that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is on an expedition. He has gone and he is on some expedition and it might take him a long while before he will return. So Uwais al-Qarni is very sad indeed. But he remembers what his mother told him. That, oh Uwais, you only go for a short while and then you're going to return. And he thinks to himself, I am in Medina. And if I just prolong a little bit longer, there's a chance of meeting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he says, no, I cannot go and violate my mother's hopes on me. So instantly, the very next day, Uwais al-Qarni packs up and he makes his journey back to Madinatul Munawwara, Allahu Akbar, back to Yemen. And he comes all the way back to Yemen, so it's almost now a 2 months journey. And Allahu Akbar, when he comes to Yemen, the mother is all excited that, oh, Uwais, did you meet Rasulullah? Tell me about the Prophet of Allah. And Uwais said, oh, mom, in the end of the day, you told me to return. And subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not there. So I gave up the chance of me becoming a sahabi, but I will rather choose the position of being a dutiful son. My beloved sons and daughters, today we cannot become sahaba. We cannot become tabi'in. We cannot become tab'ut tabi'in. We cannot become khayrul qurun al-ula. And maybe we cannot even become ulama and shuyukh and muftis. But you can stand the shoes of Uwais al-Qarni today in the 21st century where you can become a dutiful son or a dutiful daughter. And that position of becoming a dutiful son, see how Allah Ta'ala recognizes it and Allah highlights it and how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam endears this person that he not becomes just a normal tabi'i, but subhanallah, he scales up to become the crown of the tabi'in, that he is like how Abu Bakr is the best of sahaba. If he became a sahabi, he would have been an ordinary sahabi. But he remained amongst the tabi'een, but because of his dutifulness to his mother, he scaled up and became the crown of all the tabi'een. He's the Abu Bakr of the tabi'een. The hadith is in Muslim where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there's a man in Yemen and he will come to you and his name is Uwais. And subhanallah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam termed him as khayru tabi'een, the best of tabi'een. And why? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives the reason. فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ بَارًا لِوَالِدَتِهِ, because he was dutiful to his mother. Now my beloveds, how would Rasulullah know? How Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows about Uwais? How does Nabi sallam know about Uwais's details? As we will learn in the hadith, Nabi sallam gives more details about him. And how does Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know that he is dutiful to his mother? Obviously, he was informed by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And information from Jibreel comes from where? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recognizes him. Allah ta'ala highlights him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him such glory that till today we speak glowingly of this man. We don't know much of his life. I tried to open some kitabs and trying to do some research about him. There's not much about him. We don't know much about him, but the one thing we know about him is so great that it puts him on the top margin of the tabi'een And his name is so glowing that we know nothing much about him, but the one quality makes him stand out, and we all know his name. And many other tabi'een, maybe there's accolades about them and kitabs written about them, but they never stand next to the shoulders of Uwais. And what was that quality? That one quality we know, that he loved his mother, and he served his mother, and he was endeared to his mother and dutiful. Now, he comes back to Yemen. And in Yemen, my beloved brothers and sisters, subhanAllah, he serves his mother. And time comes for his mother to pass away. And all of us have to leave. And subhanAllah, the young boy, he sees his mother pass away. And very grieved, he buries his mother. My beloveds, when we lose our parents, it's not easy. And it's a scar that will remain on our hearts forever. But my beloved, subhanAllah, sometimes we are older and we are independent of our parents. But remember something, you still need your parents. No matter how old you are, no matter where you are, you will need your parents all the time. It's their du'as at night. It's their crying for you. It's their tears and their concern for you that keeps you up and going. You know, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma were very, very sad. And they said, let's go to Ayman. Ayman was like a mother to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She nurtured him when he was young. And then she spent her whole life in his service. And then later, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa passed away even before her. So she was still alive after him. She's the only individual that seen the entire life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa from the beginning till the end. So Ayman radiallahu anha, she was an Abyssinian slave and then freed and married to Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu an, and their child was Usama radiallahu an. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam loved this family dearly. So Ayman, she's sitting in her home, and Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma comes. They knock on the door, they seek permission, they come in, and they start mentioning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This causes Ayman to cry profusely. So Abu Bakr and Umar realize that, you know what, we're not doing anything good here. We are actually mentioning Rasulullah, and this is causing sentiments and emotions in Ayman, and she's crying. So they try to lighten her burden and said that, Ayman, don't you know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was riveted with a lot of problems? And that is why when he was passing away, Fatima radiallahu anha came by his side. And Fatima radiallahu anha said, wa huzna, you know, so much pain on my father. And Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la huzna ala abik ba'da hadha al-yawm. That after today when I pass away and go to Allah, there's no pain on me. Allah will alleviate all my pain. The pain stops in this world. So my beloveds, you know, Ayman says to Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhumah that ultimately Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a much better place. In a much better place. So why cry for him? Be happy for him. So Ayman said, yes, we know Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a better place. But he is going left us as yatims and orphans. The minute he went, wahi stopped between us and Allah. The du'as of Rasulullah that he made for us as an ummah stops. That is what I am crying of, for our loss, not Nabi Sassam's loss. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, subhanallah, is only, you know, in the end of the day enjoying. But we are the losers, we are the ones that don't have the du'as of our Nabi anymore. In the morning, subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's worry for us has disappeared now. That's why Anas radiallahu anhu said that we buried the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we put him in his grave and we came out of the grave. And already we felt the level of our iman come lower. The Prophet ﷺ just passed away. Hardly one day later, we already felt that our iman went lower. He was the powerhouse of nur and the powerhouse of hidayah that Allah Ta'ala put in this world. So same thing with our parents. They're there, but we don't appreciate them. But the day they're gone, we will realize that how much their du'as meant to us. When we are in trouble, we phone our parents. And we tell them our problems. They sit on the musalla and they cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those tears, there's one narration I came across myself that the dua of a father for his child is more powerful than the du'as of the anbiya of the Bani Israel. So subhanallah, in the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the malaika without parents. The malaika do not have mothers and fathers. Alright? They just created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He has made some of His creations, like certain animals or whatever. They have parents, but they don't know their parents. The turtles, they give, you know, eggs. They bury the eggs and they go into sea. And that egg hatches, that poor turtle does not have no idea who's his mother and father. He just has to find his life and carry on. But Allah Ta'ala has made human beings such that we are very attached to our mothers and fathers. And not only that, furthermore, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has not just made us attached, but has put Jannah under the feet of our mother and father. And that is why Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that that person who constantly hurts his mother and father, لا يقبل منه صرف ولا عدل. No fard or no nafil prayer, no amount of sadaqah can be accepted from this person until he does not cheer up his parents again. Until he does not cheer up his parents again. So my beloved brothers and sisters, subhanallah, Uwais al-Qarni comes back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His mother passes on. And he realizes that now what I need to do is go back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I need to race back to Madinatul Munawwara. So instantly he takes everything. He's very sad that he lost his mother. But he's also excited that now he can dedicate his entire life to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he comes back to Madinatul Munawwara. He's going through the mountains and his memories are soaked with the love. Me and you go to Medina today and we're in the bus. And the tears are running and we're listening to the nasheeds. And we're saying the salawat in happiness that we are going to the court of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say our salam. Can you imagine the emotions of Uwais al-Qarni walking towards Medina, thinking, I'm going to meet the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm going to perform the Fajr Salah behind the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm going to be from amongst the Ahle Sufa and listen to hadith whole day from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as he's going, his shauq and his enthusiasm to Medina and meeting the Prophet is only increasing. And mashallah, he comes to Medina and he is rushing towards the masjid to go for the second time, get a chance to meet the Prophet. But subhanallah, when he comes to the masjid, all he experiences is the wailing and the crying of Sahaba. And when he asks, what is it? Why is everyone crying? What happened in Medina? What catastrophe hit? They tell him, توفي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم منذ أيام. It's just a few days has passed and we have buried the greatest of man that lived in the earth, Muhammadur Rasulullah. So there's no way of Uwais al-Qarni actually meeting the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this sealed the fate of Uwais not meeting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was really sad. He went to the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said his salam and he was so overtaken by love that he wanted to emulate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the T. And he immediately asked the Sahaba, Sifli Rasulullah, explain to me Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they said to him that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would wear his, you know, lower garment in this way. Immediately he fixed it. And then his top garment like this, immediately he altered it. And then they said Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was missing some teeth because in the battle of Uhud, he was hurt and some of the teeth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was made shaheed. So instantly he took a stone or a rock and he pulled out and took out his teeth that the Sahaba showed. And his extreme love was that if my Nabi did not enjoy these teeth of eating, then how I, his lover, Uwais, would enjoy those teeth. Obviously we are not warranted to do that. We are only warranted to follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But this individual's love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so intense that he went to this measure to be exactly like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that a man will come to you and he will come from Yemen. وَإِسْمُهُ أُوَيْسِ. And his name will be Uwais. خَيْرُ التَّابِعِينَ. the best of the tabi'in, كان به برس. He had leprosy. There was a whiteness on his skin. His entire body turned into a odd white, a pale white. Why? Because of leprosy. فَدَعَ اللَّهُ. He's a pious man, and his du'as are readily accepted. His du'as are readily accepted. The ulama mentioned under this story and under many other ayat that if a person is dutiful to his parents and he takes the du'as of his parents, there's obviously the akhirah, there are many, many rewards. But instantly in his life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show him three benefits. Three benefits. Number one, his own children will be the coolness of his eyes. As how he is the coolness of his parents' eyes, Allah will make his children, alhamdulillah, obedient to him. Birru aba'akum, taburrukum abna'ukum. Be kind to your parents, in turn Allah will make your children kind to you. Number one. Number two, Allah will give him surplus in rizq and in life. The person's lifespan will be increased. You will live many more years. Allah Ta'ala will increase your life for you. And also your rizq. Many people come and say, you know what, Shaykh, subhanAllah, I'm having it very difficult. You know, financially I'm strained. And I would hear from my asatiza and my shuyukh, one of the questions they would ask such people were, that how is your relationship with your parents? If the relationship with the parents are strained, and the relationship with the parents is sour, immediately they would, you know, say that the reason why financially you're in so much difficulty is because you don't have the blessings of your parents. Try to make them happy somehow and see how Allah Ta'ala will open your rizq for you. So your life, your rizq. And subhanAllah, the last benefit of being good to your parents in this world is your du'as are accepted. Allahu Akbar. When you're good to your parents, Allah puts power in your du'a. And we see this in the story of Uwais, that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Uwais' du'as are very potent. O Umar and O Ali, make sure that when he comes, you ask him to make du'a for you. And that's why, subhanAllah, in another narration altogether, it comes that one day, and it was on the day of Arafah, Uwais al-Qarni was a very simple man. He never fleshed the cards that, you know what, the Prophet done this for me, and the Prophet done that for me, and the Prophet said, my du'as are accepted, and the Prophet... He was a very humble servant, and he hid away his piety, and he was looking and tending to the camels in Arafah. Word got around that the famous Uwais al-Qarni is in town. And Abu Umar radiallahu anhu and Ali radiallahu anhu went to go and look for him. They found him tending to the camels. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu asked him, min ayn, from where? So subhanAllah, he said, from Yemen. So immediately Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu got the feeling that this is Uwais. So he says, wa ismuka, what is your name? So he could have said Uwais, but if he said Uwais, Uwais is his known name, everyone knows him, he will give out his identity. And he's trying to, subhanAllah, disguise himself to be a commoner, not to be recognized. So instantly he says that Abdullah, my name is Abdullah, I'm the servant of Allah. Right? Min amati nas, I'm just one of the commoners, I'm tending to the camels, I don't know why you are picking up interest in me. This is how much they, you know, today if you a hafiz of Quran, for example, and you're in a masjid and the imam comes a little bit late, you are, subhanAllah, edgy now, they must know I'm a hafiz or they can put me forward. Yeah? Subhanallah, you've done an accounting degree, and there's a small platform for someone to prove something, or to be a chairman, or to be a trustee of something. You know, your shoulders are already up. You want everyone to know who you are with your limited experience. But why? Because you want to be the person in charge. So subhanAllah, Uwais al-Qarni, he had a big car to flash. But he was trying to be very, very humble. And subhanAllah, he does not give up his identity. But Umar radiallahu anhu knew who he was. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu then said, that are you the Uwais al-Qarni that had the mother? And you had the leprosy that Rasulullah told us about? So definitely Uwais then could not, you know, subhanAllah, lie any further. Not that he lied, but he was trying to disguise himself, but he couldn't now speak an open lie. So he said, yes, I'm Uwais and I'm from Qarni and I had this mother, that's true. So subhanAllah, both Ali radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhuma, they both said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that you will come, and he said that we both should ask dua from you. These are sahaba, these are khalifas, mashallah. Umar ibn al-Khattab and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhuma, the khulafa of the Muslimin. But yet they are asking dua from a commoner, a person is looking after camels, and he's not even a sahabi, he's a tabi'i, and he comes from Yemen. On what? On the fact that this man was good to his mother. And his du'as would be accepted because of that. And subhanAllah, again his humbleness. He picks up his hands and he says, oh Allah, they see in me something I can't see of myself. But because of their belief in what they say, I ask you, oh Allah, grant both of them the shafa'ah and easiness on the day of Qiyamah. Ameen. Simple as that. You know, Bilal radiallahu anhu and his brother, the two of them, subhanAllah, they wanted to go and they wanted to propose for two girls. So the two brothers, Bilal radiallahu anhu, the muaddin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the treasurer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the man that would be pulled on the scorching heat of Makkah on the sands, and huge boulders would be put on his chest. Subhanallah, he comes and he wants to get married. Now, naturally, you want to go get married, you knock on the door, and the father-in-law opens the door, and you want not one daughter, you want two daughters for you and your brother. You have to impress. You have to. Bilal radiallahu anhu is poor, he doesn't have much money, but he could pull out the card of deen. He could say, you know what, I'm the muaddin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you know when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Jannah, my footsteps was heard in Jannah? Do you know that? I will take your daughter with me into Jannah. Subhanallah, he could say, do you know Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never trust anyone with his money but me? I was the treasurer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did he say, you know what, in Makkah al-Mukarramah, when everyone had it easy, I was taken on the scorching heat and I was, you know, hit, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised me Jannah because of that? Do you know? But no, he never say all that. To him, that was done for Allah. And all he said was that nahnu abdan. Me and my brother are two slaves. Jina min al-habasha. We came from Habasha. Kunna dalin. Subhanallah, fahadan Allah. Kunna adilla, fa'azzan Allah. We were, subhanallah, both slaves. Allah Ta'ala freed us. We didn't have guidance, Allah Ta'ala granted us guidance. And there we are what we are in front of you. If you get us married with your daughters, falhamdulillah, we praise Allah. And if you do not want to get us married, no ill feelings, jazakumullah khair, we make dua, Allah Ta'ala grant you better son-in-laws than us. Ay my, Bilal is saying this. When I read this, subhanallah, and I heard this, I'm saying like, we are hardly... We nothing. But yet, when we want our work done, we throw so many cards out. You know, I'm part of this organization. You know, my father is that doctor. You know this. We want to impress. But we hardly have anything to impress. And these people had the world to impress. They had the words of Rasulullah. They are jannatis. But they were very humble in their words. Allah Ta'ala grant us that. Ameen. So my beloveds, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah s.a.w. is sitting. Abu Dharr is with him, and the angels come down, and Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam greets the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and says, Ya Rasulullah, give salam to Abu Dharr. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was amazed. Abu Dharr, you know him? Ya Jibreel, and we're talking about Abu Dharr. Do you know who's Abu Dharr? And Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam said, why don't I know who's Abu Dharr? Leave me alone. All the angels in the seven skies know Abu Dharr by name. That's what we want to be. We want to familiarize ourselves in the, subhanAllah, realm of the Akhirah. Who cares about how many followers you have on Facebook? Who cares about if you put a post, if you have 100 likes? Who cares about how many people follow you or how many people listen to you? Who cares about, subhanAllah, my beloveds, I promise you, I take a qasam wallahi, the day you pass away, it's all over. You go in your grave, you're alone there, there's no one with you. And after a year or 2 years, people even stop talking about you. Now and then your name will come. After 10 years, once in maybe a year or once in 6 months, people will talk about you. And after 50 years, no one will speak about you. So who cares about what's happening now? My beloved, subhanAllah, familiarize yourself in the akhirah. Let the malaika talk about you. There was one sahabi, he would read Quran here. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I went to Jannah. Either in a dream or it could be in Mi'raj, Allahu A'lam. But Nabi Akrim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I heard his voice in Jannah. His recitation was echoing in Jannah. And Nabi Akrim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told the malaika, but my sahabi is still in the world, he never died. How is his recitation echoed in Jannah? The malaika said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah loves his recitation so much that when he reads, his recitation is amplified in Jannah. That's what we want. We want our recitations to be heard by the malaika. We want, subhanAllah, the malaika to be waiting for us that the day we pass away, Allah takhafi wa la tahzani. They come, Allah says in the Quran Kareem, they stand in lines, the malaika. We can see with our physical eyes, the door opens and the janazah car is there, the burial car is there. And we can see a whole lot of men waiting to take the bier. But close those eyes and open the spiritual eyes, there's malaika. Allah takhafi, come. Your grave is waiting for you. Your end suit is waiting for you. Your penthouse is waiting for you. Come. We're taking you to your Lord. Al-mawtu jisrul habibi ilal habib. Death is nothing but a bridge from the lover to the beloved. If you don't die, how are you going to meet your beloved? Allah takhafi wa la tahzani. Don't fear. Don't grieve. وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوْعَدُونَ. And have the bashara and the glad tidings of Jannah that is awaiting for you. نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاءُكُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْ So we are your guardians. We are with you. We are your protectors. Allahu Akbar. My beloved, subhanAllah. Look, Sayyidina Uwais al-Qarni. He comes to Madinatul Munawwara in another hadith. So he comes, Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Uwais that he would have, subhanAllah, he had leprosy. And I told you his du'as was accepted because of his dutifulness to his mother. He made du'a to Rasulullah sallallahu, he made du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did he say? He said, Oh Allah, I have leprosy. And I beseech you and I ask you and I beg you, take my leprosy away. Oh Allah ta'ala, relieve me from my leprosy. And leave mawdi dirham, a place of one dirham, a coin, a 50 cent coin approximately, so much on my hand with the leprosy, like a mark, a scar. Why? Because later in life, when I'm cured, I don't want to forget my sickness that you cured me from. So if I have some of that mark on my body, it will constantly remind me of your favor on me. أَذْكُرُ نِعْمَتَكَ يَا رَبِّي. I can still remember your ni'mah upon me. How many times we were sick, my beloveds? How many times we were sick, subhanAllah? We were ill. And who brought us from that illness back to health? But the minute we hit health, we forgot Allah. We forgot as if we were not sick. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, وَإِذَا مَسَّتْهُمْ ذُرْ When difficulty comes, دَعَانَا قَائِمًا They're standing, sitting, making dua, frequenting the masjids. Then all of a sudden, within 1 week, for 10 years, you never have one imam's number on your phone. But in 1 week, because of your issues, you got all the imams of Melbourne and all the imams of whole of Australia on your phone, subhanAllah. Now what happened? And Allahu Akbar, then you, subhanAllah, Allah Ta'ala says, when your death is coming to you, now you remember. Allah Ta'ala says, وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَ إِذِنِ الْمَسَاقُ Now it's time to go to Allah. You say, bring the raqi. Bring the raqi. إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِيَ وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاقُ You say, where's the raq? Raq means raqi. Bring the sheikh, tell him to come and read. I'm not feeling well. I'm feeling down. Tell him to come and read on me. Now even if subhanAllah 10 sheikhs come and read the Quran 20 times, it's not going to help you now. Your life is gone. Raq. Now this is when your shins start hitting each other. Now when the akhirah, the veil is open. And now you can see Jannah and Jahannam. Now it's a different story altogether. So my beloved, subhanAllah, in the end of the day, we were sick. And then Allah says, He remembered us. But when we take Him out of His difficult, مَرَّكَ أَلَّمْ يغني بالأمس أو مرة لم يمسه ضر. No difficulty ever came his way. He acts like, you know what, I was always good. He forgot his bad days. He forgot his rainy days. Sometimes financially we in trouble. Who delivers us from that? Now we got money and we are so proudful. We forgot our origins. We forgot where we came from. We forgot, subhanAllah, there were days we never have food. We forgot there were days that, subhanAllah, we were in need of other people. And today, now we have it all, we forget. We become proudful. We have attitudes. Just because you're driving a bit of a nice car now, just because you're living a little bit up, all of a sudden you're acting very differently. In the end of the day, Allah Ta'ala is the giver and Allah is the taker. Overnight, Allah Ta'ala can snatch away everything that He has given us. Allah Ta'ala reminds not only me and you, but even Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is, mashallah, marching into Makkatul Mukarramah. He has 12,000 Sahaba with him. He has support. He's become great. He is a huge force to deal with. His own enemies are fearing him now. The Romans are shaking on the name of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The entire empire of Islam is expanding. At that moment, Allah stops His Nabi. And Allah whispers in the ears of His Nabi, advisors, that, oh my Nabi, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. O Prophet, remember you the leader. And you are, mashallah, the commander. And you are the chief general. And you are everything right now. But remember, you came from where, O Prophet of Allah? Remember, you were the yatim of Makkah. You remember, you were a small baby and no one wanted to take you to give you milk. And because there were no babies around, Halima picked you up and took you to give you milk. You had no father, O Muhammad. You were yatim, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يَتِيمًا فَآوَى وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًّا فَهَدَى. Now you are sitting and Jibreel is meeting you. And Mikael is waiting in line. Now you are sitting and mashallah the wahi is in your heart and the Quran is there. And you are touching the lives of millions of people. But O Prophet of Allah, don't forget those days that you were sitting in Mount Hira and you were bewildered and you were looking for something and some sign of guidance. You were in need of it and you were looking for it. Remember those days too. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. Now Allah has opened the world for you. Now, mashallah, the booty and the spoils of war is coming from Bahrain and coming from Persia. Now, alhamdulillah, Aisha radiallahu anha said, towards the end of the life, at least we should eat something. Once Khaybar was taken over, then at least some vegetables and fruits would come into the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But O Prophet of Allah, Allah has given you now. But remember the days when you never have. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I had nothing. I would look after the sheep for the people of Quraysh in the mountains for few pennies. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, me and Bilal never have anything to eat for days except the little food that Bilal could hide under his armpits. 3 years you were in Sha'bi Abi Talib and you would eat the leaves of the trees. Remember where you came from. Remember what you had and where we took you and what we gave you. And how that will be appreciated is your reactions to those same people. وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. So when someone poor comes to you, don't try to, subhanAllah, control him. Don't try to be authoritative with him. Don't try to manipulate him, because you were just like him one day. وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. You know, be kind to everyone and praise the Lord and subhanAllah be in gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my beloved, subhanAllah, Uwais al-Qarni says to Allah, cure me from my leprosy, but leave a space on my hand so I can look at it always and remember where I came from, what I had, what was my problem, and I do not become proudful. I always, subhanAllah, remember your favor upon me. He then comes in another narration when he comes to Madinatul Munawwara. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a jubbah. He had a mantle. And who would not want to wear the mantle and the jubbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It comes in some narrations that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam once came and he asked if there's anyone that wants to take qisas or take some sort of retribution from the Prophet of Allah, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was getting the strong feeling that probably he will go. So one sahabi said, "Ana ya Rasulullah, myself, I have something that you've done against me." And other sahaba were a bit upset that how can you make a claim against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then furthermore, to aggravate the matter, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, when you committed this against me, I never have a shit, I never have a mantle, I never have a top of garment. So you need to shed your shawl." So this even aggravated the sahaba more. How dare? And then when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam done it, he came and he hugged the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam dearly. And he said, "Ya Rasulullah, one day I was working in my fields and you came from behind and subhanAllah, you hugged me tight. And I thought, whenever will I get a chance to hold my Nabi again? Among thousands of people, you probably will leave us. So I took the opportunity, please forgive me." Nabi Akram Samson's mantle, his jubbah, he would wear it. On Jummah, he would come and he would have his mantle, he have his jubbah. And every sahabi was green in envy to, subhanAllah, win that specific jubbah. Sometimes someone passes away, you say, "You know what, I don't want the inheritance or whatever, but the old items of my mother and father, give me that. That is my greatest remembrance." So every sahabi wanted the jubbah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Was that jubbah going to Abu Bakr? Was that jubbah going to Umar? Was it going to the Mufti of this Ummah, Mu'adh bin Jabal? Was it going to the Amin of this Ummah, Abu Baida bin Jarrah? Who was it going to? Everyone was green in envy. We want it. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wasallam gifted his jubbah to Uwais al-Qarni. And again, on the merit that this man was kind to his mother. And he said to Umar radiallahu anhu, that when Uwais comes to Medina, wear him this mantle and ask him to make dua on behalf of my ummah as well. And when he did come, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu gifted the jubbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which every sahabi wanted, to a man that was a tabi'i, and on accordance of his piety and dutifulness to his mother, he was granted the jubba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Such an honor indeed. And he made dua on behalf of this ummah, subhanallah. So in conclusion, I would love to say, my beloveds, wallahi, by the qasam of Allah, looking at the beautiful story of Uwais al-Qarni, all we can say, that if we want real happiness in our life and in our hereafter, we need to be loving towards our mother. Our mother is a very, very great, subhanAllah, gift to us and our parents, of course, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Cherish her while she's alive. Nourish her. Forgive if she has any difficulties and problems. Forgive and overlook. You know, in the end of the day, subhanAllah, a person was passing away in the time of Rasulullah and he could not say the kalima. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the mother, "Are you happy with him?" And she said, "No. He always gives preference to his wife over me." Someone asked me that other day, "Mufti sahab, must we give preference to our mother or our wife? Because subhanAllah, it's always a battle. My wife says something, my mother says something, and I'm in between." I said, "Don't give preference to your mother too, and don't give preference to your wife too, over each other. Each one have a set of hukuk and rights. The haqq of your wife, learn what's her hukuk. Her hukuk is you give her a proper place to stay. Your hukuk is you love her. Your hukuk is you protect her. Your hukuk is her hukuk is you spend on her generously according to your means. That's her hukuk. Your mother's hukuk is not clashing. Allah Ta'ala will not allow the hukuk of one another to clash. The tension comes when the wife gets jealous and she wants to take you away from your mother. The tension comes when the mother sometimes acts over, subhanAllah, authoritative, and she wants to take away the hukuk of the wife. So both mother have to understand, now my son got married, I need to give him his freedom with his family. And the wife have to understand, my husband has a duty to his mother, I must help him do good actions by supporting him to support his mother and father. If both the mother and the daughter-in-law thinks this way, there'll be no clash whatsoever. And the man also has to take responsibility of looking after both. So someone said so beautiful, subhanAllah, Allahu Akbar, your mother is your crown. So keep her on your head. And your wife was made from your rib, keep her in your heart. Keep your mother here with respect and love your wife. And inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't give, you know, subhanallah, fadila, in the sense of where you start favoring one in such a way that you exclude the other one completely. So she said, he said, you know, in the end of the day, my son gives a lot of preference to his wife over me and he makes me cry. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, then forgive him. She said, I can't, he hurt me too much. She said, okay, then Nabi sallallahu alayhi said, bring the firewood, let's light it and let's burn this man. So she said, no, you can't do that. He's my son after all. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi said, you don't want him to burn here, but in the fire of Jahannam, he's going to die. Allah is going to give him Jahannam. That's why he can't say the kalima, because he upset you. She said, in that case, I forgive him. Nabi Akareem sallallahu alayhi wanted to motivate within her the passion of a mother. So subhanallah, she said, okay, I forgive him, and she walked away. The man said the kalima, he passed away. So subhanallah, it's very, very important we keep our parents happy. Phone them, care for them. How many a mother I know, they talk to me, sometimes we go and visit the old age homes. My child has not phoned me for 3 months. My child has not phoned me for 2 weeks, for 1 week. Subhanallah, every second, third day we should phone our parents, at least, if not every day. Send them kind messages. Subhanallah, if you are far. If you are close, take advantage and visit them. Kiss their hands, make their service. And don't think it as subhanallah, they are, you know, being a burden on you. Someone said so beautiful. Umar radiallahu ta'ala, a man came to Umar radiallahu ta'ala and said, I picked my mother up and I took her for Hajj. I made the whole Hajj on my back. Have I fulfilled the duty of my mother? Umar radiallahu ta'ala said, your entire Hajj with her and holding her does not fulfill even the little droplets of milk that she breastfed you with. When you were young and sick, she cared for you with great hope in her heart you would live. She is old and sick now. As much as you love and you care for her, in the back of your mind, you know she's going to pass away very, very soon, and then you will be free. So the whole idea and the whole intention behind is very different. The motivation between what your mother done for you and what you are doing now is a world difference. You can never ever measure it up, the quality. Sayyidina Usama radiallahu ta'ala anhu, subhanallah, he said, I should not eat with my mother from the same plate. I would give my mother everything and wait for her and then eat a little bit after her. Why? Out of fear that probably my hand goes onto something. My mother saw it, she likes it, but she's a bit slow and I'm fast and I take it and I eat it. And subhanallah, because of her love for me, she lets it go. I rather allow her to take the best food and eat, and then I eat after her, subhanallah. One day she said she's craving for pomegranate. Usama radiallahu ta'ala anhu runs to the souq and he goes to, subhanallah, buy pomegranates. The seller tells him, you know what, it's very expensive today because we have very limited stock. If you come tomorrow, I will give you, subhanallah, there's a new, you know, subhanallah, new stock coming in. There's more fruit coming in. I will give you, inshallah ta'ala, at a much better price. Usama radiallahu anhu said, I don't care of the price. فَإِنَّ أُمِّي تَتْلُبُهُ الْآنِ My mother is craving for it now. The value of fulfilling my mother's wish now can never be fulfilled tomorrow. So I will give the top dollar, doesn't matter, but I will fulfill my mother's wish right now. How many times our mother asked us for simple things and we said straight no and we don't care. May Allah Ta'ala grant us the tawfiq and soften our hearts to understand the benefit and the greatness in us caring for our parents, loving them, and subhanallah, revering our mothers and keeping them close to our hearts. And if our mothers passed away, may Allah Ta'ala fill the qabr with noor. We make dua, Allah Ta'ala, fill the qabr with noor. And all those who lose their parents, may Allah Ta'ala grant them the sabr and jameel to deal with it. For verily, years will go and you still feel that vacuum. When Eid come, that smiling mother will not be there. When, subhanallah, Ramadan comes, you will remember her du'as for you. And when you're in difficulties, you will definitely crave for those phone calls where your father and your mother gave you that courage. Cherish them, and if they are gone, then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, read for them, do sadaqah jariyah for them, and then inshallah you will be written from amongst the dutiful sons and daughters. May Allah Ta'ala grant us all tawfiq. Remember, Uwais al-Qarni was just a commoner. Uwais al-Qarni was no mufti. Uwais al-Qarni was no sahabi. But just because of his dutifulness to his parents, Allah elevated him to the stage that his du'as was accepted. Great people like Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Ali were commanded by Rasulullah to ask for du'a from him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him the pedestal of being the best of tabi'een. And not only that, but also subhanallah, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa left his jubba that the entire sahaba fraternity were envious of, left it to a man that cared for his mother. Jazakumullahu khairan, and inshallah ta'ala soon we'll be having more programs ongoing. For the last few weeks we have been slack. There's a few reasons for that. We had some technical difficulties with our cameras, number one. Number two, also this face to face now, and there's a lot of other programs that we are attending, so it makes it a bit difficult. But inshallah, very soon all these things will be solved and we'll be back for 2021 at least every week, inshallah ta'ala, with our live segments, so everyone can benefit everywhere around the world. Make dua for us here at Darul Arqam. We are always connected. We care for you. You care for us. We make dua for one another. Jazakumullahu khairan. Ahsan al-jaza. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.